Hari Om. Good evening and a very warm welcome once again, friends. Aje madhyane suraj. 7 days week and with Swamini Vimalananda, in fact, હું ગુજરાતીમાં જ બોલી શકું ને એ ખૂબ સરસ સમજે કારણ કે આપ સૌ જાણો છો. મેં સ્વામીનીજીને કહ્યું કે ગૂગલ ઉપર ખૂબ રિસર્ચ કર્યો. અધ્યાત્મનંદ સ્વામીજી મને કહેશે એમના સ્ટેચરના સ્વામીજીઓ તો ઘણા મળ્યા મને નામ આપણા ગુજરાતી ઓરિજિનના, પણ ગુજરાતી ઓરિજિનના સ્વામીની વાત કરીએ તો ધ વન એન્ડ ઓનલી વન. અને એ હોય એટલે આનંદ જ આનંદ. ઇનફેક્ટ એમ એ વીક ઇઝ ઓલ અબાઉટ આનંદ. અધ્યાત્માનંદ, અનુભવાનંદ, વિમલાનંદ, આનંદ, ઇટ્સ ઓલ અબાઉટ આનંદ. યેસ્ટરડે વી ટોક્ડ અબાઉટ રિઝોલ્વિંગ conflicts through happiness. How, and so beautifully it was put across, that conflicts are within, not without. And if you have the right approach, you can manage all your conflicts. Friends, we saw Ramayana, Bhagavad Gita, the Shiva Sutras. In fact, it was a blend, you know, Shiva Purana, Shiva Sutras more. But I was always wanting, and you know, Vimalananda is with us for umpteen number of times now. We've lost the count, you know. There are some speakers whose visits we don't count. Adhyatmananda, Anubhavananda, Vimalananda included. And it's a privilege to have them over and over again, even in the midst of their most busy schedules. But then we are fortunate that their love and affection for AMA brings them with us here whenever we request them. And this time I had a dream that I want her to talk on Mahabharata. Not to create Mahabharata.
It's already there.
But it's already there, she rightly said. You know, we want to resolve conflicts because perhaps when you know, the word Mahabharata itself is conflict. You know, આપણે એમ કેવું હોય કે ભાઈ અહીંયા મહાભારત ઉભું કરવું છે, દેટ મીન્સ યુ નો ક્રિએટ કોન્ફ્લિક્ટ. બટ દેન આઈ થિંક યુ કેન લર્ન બેસ્ટ રિગાર્ડિંગ રિઝોલ્વિંગ કોન્ફ્લિક્ટ from a scripture which has created the maximum number of conflicts. Because where the problem lies, the solution also is embedded therein. And that is why we are very happy that today we are going to listen to her on conflict management. And when it's Mahabharata, it's nothing else but strategies. Strategies. But then, for a good cause, as I am sure she will narrate, strategies are permitted within that Lakshman Rekha. I am sure she'll dwell on that. And we look forward to a most delightful evening with Swamini Vimalananda. Friends, I hardly need to say much about her. In fact, I always say that perhaps she became an architect in her academic qualifications so that she could truly become an architect of several lives of human beings. And that is what she has been doing for the last so many years. And what she has taken as a mission is she heads the international school of the Chinmaya mission at Coimbatore. She travels far and wide, she does everything, but her core attachment is with not even the youth, I would say the children. Because that is where, you know, the true architecture, you know, the future of the country is to be shaped. So we are all very proud of her. As I said, an extra pride is there in our minds and hearts because she belongs to us. Someday probably we will hear her only in Gujarat. Of course, Gujarati will come free flowing. Huh? Gujarati, Hindi, English. Very few speakers, you know, have this flair. And friends, this week all days are going to be different. You know, you saw the difference. Brahmavihari ji and Prema Pandurang, Anubhavanand ji. Today, in fact, if I'm not leaking out a secret, Swami Adhyatmanand ji has confirmed that on Sunday he is going to have Bhagavatam so that you can enjoy the true rasa of Bhagavatam with the music, you know, and melody. It's going to be something totally different. And I don't think I need to say much because we will hear her with rapt attention for almost 100 minutes. It's on behalf of AMA, on behalf of all of you sitting in this auditorium and in all nooks and corners of AMA, watching through the video projection, may I request our treasurer, Divyesh Bhai, to please offer Swamini ji flowers. And friends, we begin, but not before, a roaring applause from all of you.
Vakratunda Mahakaya Surya Koti Samaprabha Nirvignam Kuru Me Deva Sarvakaryeshu Sarvada Om Shri Mahaganapataye Namaha Saraswati Namastupyam Varade Kamarupini Vidyarambham Karishyami Siddhir Bhavatun Me Sadam Om Shri Mahasaraswatyai Namaha Samasta Janakalyane Niratam Karunamayam Namami Chinmayam Devam Sadgurum Brahma Vidvaram Om Shri Chinmaya Sadgurave Namaha Narayanam Namaskrityam Naram Chaiva Narottamam Devim Saraswatim Vyasam Tato Jayamudirayet. The Hindus have four main scriptures. Number one, the basic, the Mool Granthas, the Shruti, or the Vedas, four Vedas. The second, the Smritis, Bhagavad Gita and Manusmriti, etc., many, many more. The third, the Puranas. See, I told you, in spite. Whoever has done it, just press it, because again, you will have the... Can someone just switch it off, please? Yeah. So, you have the Puranas. How many number? 80. And the fourth main scripture are the Itihasas. Which are the two main Itihasas? Ramayana and Mahabharata. So, Mahabharata iti is a Itihasa. It is not a war. Is that understood? Because everyone thinks of Mahabharata as what? A war. No. Mahabharata is a Itihasa. It is a katha. It is a war. It is a history. Iti ha asa. Thus it is said. We have our own unique style of narrating history, which is very different from the Western way of narrating history. And we do it with a purpose. And there's nothing wrong because it's our way. There's no right way and wrong way. It's our way, full stop. For us, history is not about dates. History is about lessons learned from history. Is that understood? It's not about which king came after whom and what. No, it's about the important lessons that you and I learn so that A, we become a little wiser. Not that history doesn't repeat itself. Many of us make the same foolish mistake again and again in our own lives also. Forget about after us. Is it true or not? But still, history is all about the lessons of history, the great, great things that can happen in this world. And at the end of it, history is about letting us know that every one of us, at the end of a day, is a small little nothing in the flow of time. There is a Prithvi Gita at the end of the Bhagavatam, which tells you thousands and thousands of kings came into this world. When they were there, they did big, huge things, unbelievable things. And right now, what are they? They are just nothing but dust and dust alone. So this is what we have to learn from history, and Mahabharata is a itihasa, one of the most beautiful scriptures of our tradition. Now, the Mahabharata is also called the Pancham Veda. It's got that much of importance. It's called what? The fifth Veda. Because for us, Veda is everything. Anything in line with the Vedas is authentic. Anything not in the line with Vedas is not authentic. And after all, the compiler of the Vedas himself wrote who? What? Composed the Mahabharata. And therefore, for us, it is very important. Now, what is the Mahabharata? So it is said, it is Mahatvat Bharatatvacha. Mahatvat, it is a very important, great knowledge, and you know, it's very deep. It's not a bhariche jnana, not just like that. It is, you know, it has a great, great beauty and depth and wonderful expanse of this knowledge, and that is why Mahabharata iti uchyate. That is why it's called Mahabharata. Okay, now, originally the Mahabharata had 60 lakh verses. How many? 60 lakhs. From that, 30 lakh verses were given away to the devatas. 15 lakh verses from that were given away to the Gandharvas. 14 lakhs were given away to the Pitrus, and 1 lakh was given away for Manushya. And this is what Bhagwan Vedavyasa compiled as the this. So that is why it is said that there is nothing, you know, in Bharata which is not there in Mahabharata. You understand? Every possible. Now remember, you and I know only this 1 lakh verses, but there are how many? 60 lakh. Can you imagine a composition like that? And again, look at the origin of the Mahabharata. It is not that one day Vedavyasa sat down, ki chalo, let me start writing. No. He says that when he meditated, ya apashyat sarvam antataha, it is said. When he sat for meditation, he saw the whole of the Mahabharata within himself. So it's like he got it on the seat of meditation. So it's not just composed, you know, ki basine. However, there are three main narrators of the Mahabharata. The first, who? Bhagwan Vedavyasa to who? Bhagwan Ganesha. You know the story, I'm not telling you. The second great narrator was Rishi Vaishampayana to Janmayjaya. Janmayjaya was the great grandson of Arjuna, the son of Parikshita. He was really troubled because he says, who killed my father? You know, and the Nagas, the, you know, Takshak killed the father. He was very upset about it. And he wanted to know, at that time, he wanted to take a revenge. And therefore, at that time, Rishi said, you know, who you belong to and who you are, I'll tell you your history. I'll tell you your story. And it starts, the Mahabharata. And the third great narrator of this great epic is Suta. You know, in the good old days, when they did these big, huge yajnas, which went on for months together, in between time when they had it, they did not watch reality shows or serials. So at that time, it wasn't there, fortunately, but they wanted something very interesting, you know, it's something because they've already done swaha, swaha, whole day. So now they want something which is of a entertainment value, at the same time a learning experience, a sattvic entertainment, and therefore these stories were told to the rishis of Naimisharanya. So Sudji, the Kathakar, told this great Mahabharata to them. So these three great narrators of this great epic called Mahabharata. Now, this Mahabharata has knowledge about everything, not only Mahabharata. Most of our scriptures have knowledge about varied subjects. You know, we think Mahabharata and all the Gita and all this only talks about what? Dharma and all. It's not so. You talk about astrology, you talk about mathematics. In the Mahabharata, the figures go to like 10 raised to the power of plus 16. And 10 raised to the power of minus 16. Nanotechnology has come now. But in the Western world, it was talked about in our scriptures at least 5,000 to 10,000 years before Christ. Can you imagine? So you have mathematics and you have, you know, weapons. We're talking about now nuclear weapons and chemical weapons. All of that was used. And strategies of war and philosophy and psychology and sociology and politics and... But remember, the main topic of the Mahabharata and all our scriptures was dharma. Okay? That was the main... All this was also talked about. It's not that it wasn't talked about, but the main emphasis was what? Dharma. So therefore, it becomes primarily a dharmic grantha, a scripture on spiritual knowledge, on philosophy, on religion, besides all the other topics that are discussed. Now, having explained that, I told you Mahabharata is not a war. Mahabharata is what? It's a story of the Pandavas. Okay? It's a story of who? The Pandavas. It's not Krishna who is the center of this whole story, it's the Pandavas. Okay? And because you cannot talk of the Pandavas without talking of Krishna, and therefore Bhagwan Krishna also being spoken of. But the main story is of the Pandavas and their life, you know, work and what they did. And if you talk of the Pandavas, one of the most important events in their life was what? The Mahabharata. And therefore, if you have to talk of the Pandavas, then you have to talk of the war of Mahabharata, the ultimate. Now, let's talk a little bit about, you know, what all type of numbers are involved in this. I mean, it's amazing. It's, you know, mind-boggling. See, when we think of Mahabharata, and especially, you know, I think I saw a play on Mahabharata done by somewhere it came. And Ahmedabad mein jo to ne multi stage ma karyu to ne I was so disgusted I walked off halfway and they showed you know like Hastinapur some small hamlet village like some underdeveloped village of Hare Rama they don't even know what you know the glory it was an urban place you know that time urban you know if you see Mohenjo-daro and Harappa we had it was all an urban setup it wasn't a rural village set up and they were fighting over some small little this. No. The sheer numbers is what you and I have to, you know, contemplate. The total amount of army involved in the Mahabharata war was 18 Akshauhinis. Are you aware of that? 11 were on the side of Kauravas, 7 on the side of the Pandavas. Okay? And now what is one Akshauhini? They're very interesting. 21,870, if I've got the number right, 21,870 chariots, 21,870 elephants, 65,610 horses, and 1,09,350 foot soldiers. Now, naturally, in every chariot, there would be at least two people. Naturally, the one who would drive the chariot and the one who would fight the war. Similarly, on the elephant, one who would be the mahout, who will control the elephant and the other one who would fight the war. So that means how many people were there? Anyone who's got a tuck, tuck, tuck can do that. 21,870 into 4 plus 65,610. On the horse, only one would be there, hopefully. And foot soldiers, 1,09,350. I've got the figure as, maybe I'm wrong because I'm not very good in calculation. Anyway, 2,62,440 is the number of people involved, one Akshauhini. One battalion in our words right now. And there were how many of them involved? 18 is equal to 47,23,920 is the total mass of warriors involved in this battle. Now, do you think it is a small Kaka Mama village war? Look at the scale of this war, please. It's a world war. Is it true or not? This is the war. It was not a Kaka Mama war. It was not a family feud. It was a national, at a level of a, you know, not only national, it was international, if you had to say. Because so many kingdoms were involved, so many people were involved. And therefore, and it was a very, very, what do you call it, landmark in our country. Unfortunately, can you imagine such an important event in the life of our country and it's not, does not figure in our education books and history books? Is it true or not? Bolo. Is it there as a part of the history books? Should it be there? And in small, small, little kings, we keep on this. This one the great, that one the great, that one the great. And this, do you think it should be a part of the history of our country? Koi boltu na thi bahu. Na paado ke ha paado. Such a deciding, with this many number of people involved, it's a big thing. It's a big thing. Okay, now, what happened about the war? What was the, who were the big people in the war? Lots of big people in the Bhishma Acharya. You know, giants were there, not ordinary people. If you see the, this of the people, the stature of the people, is, they were not, you know, sometimes you feel it, a general of an army or a, this is, you know, a person who has a personality, who's done something which is so tremendous. Each of the generals of the army on the Pandava side and the Kaurava side were something to be reckoned with. They were great people. So it was not war between small, this, it was war between giants. Giants on both sides. It's not giants only on one side. Bhishma Acharya, what to talk of. If he was alone was there, it's a big thing, you know. And on the other side, of course, you have all these great, you know, very, very great. Drupad was there and so many others were there. Drishtadyumna was there and Ghatotkacha. These were all great generals, great warriors who had already achieved wonderful things, name, fame, everything. Now comes something interesting. Look at the two sides. You have the Kauravas. They have been 13 years in power, okay? When, what was the other side? Where were they for the 13 years, the Pandavas? No kingdom, no power, no wealth, nothing. And these guys? They are sole monarch. Not only our Hastinapur, but they had also captured Indraprastha. And Karna had gone all over the country conquering all the other